Okay, thank you everybody for joining tonight. We're going to be discussing Brain Award. There are a lot of products in the industry that make a lot of claims, and it is easy to become skeptical, even cynical, about hearing nutritional product claims. But I'm going to ask everybody, please do not judge too quickly in this case, because what we're going to show you is going to be life-changing. But just to make a point, I'm going to play this about one-minute video.
Pressure fibula, given a mile, et cetera. So I can be able to go home tomorrow.
He's going to be so excited.
That killed him.
So we don't want to judge too quickly, because you never know what's behind what's going on. And Gina, I can hear myself. So we're going to look at a new understanding of what causes uncontrolled cravings, loss of willpower, stress intolerance, sleep disorders, chronic unhappiness, fatigue, relapse, and a whole bunch of other stuff known as reward deficiencies. We're going to look at how Brain Reward is a reward deficiency solution. So the three causes of all reward deficiencies and all addictions and, quite frankly, all chronic diseases are excessive chronic distress, unhealthy lifestyle influences, which are a combination of poor personal choices, those things that we can control, and environmental factors, those things that we can't control that we're exposed to, and genetic predispositions. So the conventional perspective has been that the addict, obese individual, and or gambler, as just a couple of examples, are just too weak to change their lives on their own, and they need intervention, group support, and even medication to be abstinent. Conventional treatments are and have always been based primarily on psychological therapy, fellowship program support for enlightenment and strength, you know, group programs and such, and medications to make subjects more manageable. 70% of Americans are now on medications, according to the Mayo Clinic. Antidepressants rank among the most prescribed medications, with 1 in 4 Americans experiencing a mental health disorder, according to the National Alliance on Mental Illness. Illegal drug use is a cancerous cultural scourge, but 60% of the people who died from a drug overdose died from taking prescription drugs. That's according to the National Institute for Drug Abuse. So it's absolutely, categorically, and profoundly time for a change. I want to welcome everybody to a new hope, for a new opportunity to have a new life. It all started in 1990 with a landmark discovery of Dr. Kenneth Blum and Dr. Ernest Noble, who published their discovery of the reward gene, at that time called the addiction gene, in the Journal of the American Medical Association. The discovery was so overwhelming that it actually rocked the addiction treatment world and was met with intense resistance that has lasted in some cases up till today. And I just want to point out, Henry David Thoreau said, "We mock what we do not understand." That also happens to be in the Bible, Jude 1:10. And it was quoted by Dan Aykroyd in Spies Like Us, for those movie watchers. Staying confined within the box of conventional dogma is a safe haven for the ignorant. They never get out unless pushed, and even then, not without a fight. So the paradigm is this: if you do what you've always done, you'll get what you've always gotten. For a different outcome, there must be a change. Stated a different way, insanity is doing the same thing over and over again and expecting a different result. So the 1990 study in JAMA, this is actually the abstract, you know, the summary of the study, and the important citation is the presence of the A1 allele, which is a variant of the dopamine D2 receptor gene, correctly classified 77% of alcoholics, and its absence classified 72% of non-alcoholics. This was just a breakthrough in understanding what caused alcoholism at that time. So we heard over and over and over again, "I can't help it, it's in my genes." But on January in 2010, the issue of Time magazine, this was the cover, "Why Your DNA Isn't Your Destiny." This was the introduction of epigenetics. Now, what is epigenetics? Well, we cannot change our genes, but we can change gene expression. Epigenetics is the study, it's a science that studies how lifestyle influences affect gene expression and how that affects overall health. And nutrigenomics is a subcategory of epigenetics that really targets how nutrition affects gene expression and how that affects overall health. So, for example, with no more than a change in diet, laboratory mice gave birth to young that differed significantly in appearance and disease susceptibility. And why is this so amazing? Because these are identical twins. So, finally, after 21 years and many hundreds of confirming studies, most of which were done to refute the premise, you know, Dr. Blum's premise, Dr. Blum's genetic basis of reward deficiencies was officially validated. On August the 15th of 2011, the American Society of Addiction Medicine published its new definition and changed definition of addiction. They state, addiction is a primary chronic disease of brain reward, motivation, memory, and related circuitry. In another paragraph, they say genetic factors account for about half of the likelihood that an individual will develop addiction. Well, we just saw that it was 77%. Environmental factors interact with a person's biology and affect the extent to which genetic factors exert their influence, back to epigenetics and nutrigenomics. So this is has a profound genetic basis. And that was published in the ASAM, American Society of Addiction Medicine, public policy statement of August 2011. 2 months after that, the International Schizophrenia Foundation published its comments. The stunning impact of ASAM's new definition was reported in their October newsletter. And they said, ASAM's new definition of addiction knocks the psychological element off center stage, redefining addiction as a neurological disorder and an imbalance in the brain's reward circuitry, also correctly referred to as reward deficiency syndrome. So it didn't eliminate the psychological aspect, it just knocked it off center stage. They realized that it wasn't a software problem, a behavioral issue, it was a behavioral consequence of a hardware problem. The brain was hardwired for reward and survival, and it's not getting the nourishment that it needs. So here's the dynamics of the brain reward cascade. I call this the symphony of neurochemistry. It starts with serotonin, it goes to enkephalin, endorphin, GABA, and dopamine. The next step down from this, by the way, is norepinephrine or noradrenaline and epinephrine or adrenaline. And beyond that is thyroid and insulin, etc. So this system right here is command control center for survival, motivation, happiness, reward satisfaction, cognition, and some aspects of memory. So when the brain's working well, each one of these steps goes through the manufacture or synthesis, the transport, reception, and function of the neurotransmitter, and the reuptake or disposal. The brain reward is formulated to optimize the gene expression of every single step for each neurotransmitter in the brain reward cascade. By the way, most of the medications like SSRIs prevent the disposal of serotonin. Now, all of these steps have elaborate feedback mechanisms that evaluate what's there and determine what needs to be manufactured. So if you're taking something that mimics serotonin or prevents it from being disposed of and maintains serotonin in the synapse, the tissue stops making serotonin. The same consequence as if you put a cast on your arm. We'll say somebody's taking an SSRI for 2 years. So let's put a cast on your arm for 2 years. What kind of shape is the muscle and the bone in that arm going to be? It's going to be atrophied and withered. The same thing happens to the tissues in the brain because the demand to make serotonin has been eliminated, has been turned off. So when somebody stops taking these SSRIs, it is quite a long journey to get back to normal, healthy functioning. And it requires nutrients. So this is another way of looking at the brain reward cascade. These are some of the genes that are influenced by many of the nutrients at specific junctures, and all these nutrients are calibrated at a specific dose to elicit a specific type of gene expression at an optimal time in the sequence of events. So this is called brain reward therapy. Now, the brain is hardwired to feel good, as I just said a little bit ago, and dopamine is the feel-good and survival neurotransmitter. Dopamine is actually the pot of gold payoff at the end of the brain reward rainbow, and it affects other neurotransmitters, hormones, and metabolic molecules like serotonin, enkephalin, endorphin, GABA, norepinephrine, cholecystokinin, insulin, leptin, ghrelin, substance P, and even ATP, the production of energy. Dopamine has five types of receptors from D1 to D5. However, the D2 receptors are the most important for cravings and reward and even survival. And there are two forms of the D2 receptors. There's the A1 and the A2, but they come in pairs because you have a mother and a father. So there's three variants. There's the A1A1, A1A2, and A2A2. People that carry the A2 gene have a complete complement, have a full number, a complete amount of dopamine D2 receptors, and there's almost no dopamine resistance. These individuals will probably not get addicted to anything. They won't be impulsive, compulsive, obsessive, unless they engage in some seriously self-abusive behavior, like maybe a college kid trying to get into a fraternity and engaging in some ridiculous consumption of, you know, some sort of narcotic or drug or alcohol, and really becomes addicted because of that excessive intake, goes into a treatment center, and he gets good nutrition and biofeedback and yoga and group therapy and all that kind of support, maybe even some meds for a while. And when he comes out of the treatment center, he doesn't relapse because he has the A2 gene. And he becomes the poster child for the treatment center. But people that have the A1 gene have an entirely different challenge. So here's about a 4-minute video.
Addiction research has focused on the neural circuitry in the brain's reward pathway, the network of neurons where our desires arise. Flowing along this network, continuously stimulating our pleasure, appetite, are the neurotransmitters that one neuron uses to talk to another. Addiction drugs work by altering the level of these neurotransmitters and slyly capturing the reward pathway.
Now, before we go any farther, I have to tell you that what you're going to see is about cocaine. However, the same phenomenon occurs with SSRIs for serotonin because of this feedback loop that I told you about. So when you have too much of something, it causes the body to turn off. Same principle when somebody's taking prednisone, it turns off their ability to make cortisone via feedback system. So what you're seeing for cocaine is applicable to any addictive substance.
All addictive drugs are Trojan horses. Every single one of the chemicals that are addictive are mimics. That is, they look like a neurotransmitter. They look like one of the chemicals that the brain uses for nerve cells to communicate with one another.
Many addictive drugs mimic one of the most powerful neurotransmitters in the reward pathway, dopamine. In the normal brain, dopamine travels across the synapse, stimulates receptors on the target neuron, and then is quickly reabsorbed by tiny molecular vacuum cleaners called dopamine transporters. But when cocaine is abused, trillions of cocaine molecules surge into the synapse, clogging the vacuum cleaners, artificially boosting the level of dopamine in the brain, producing a cocaine high.
Let's imagine a wonderful natural reward. You know, I go to a restaurant and have the best ice cream sundae I've ever had. You know, I'd have a certain amount of dopamine probably being released in my brain. But cocaine, which gets there chemically, gives your brain, gives these synapses more dopamine for a longer amount of time than it has ever experienced before.
The first high can be exhilarating, but after repeated drug abuse, the dark side to addiction begins to take its toll. The brain responds to the repeated use of cocaine and the dopamine surging in the synapse by fighting back, cutting away receptors on the neuron that are the dopamine's target. Without the receptors, dopamine can't stimulate the neuron, and the drug high is reduced. But so is enjoyment of all normal pleasures as well.
You know, none of these kids sat down and said, hey, I want to be a drug addict. Actually, what happened is, like lots of other adolescents, they played what turned out for them to be a game of Russian roulette. Something about their genes, something about their temperament that made them vulnerable so that when other kids got away, often scot-free, they got hooked. There was something different about their brain.
And what was different is they carried the A1 gene. And they have 30 to 40% less D2 receptors to begin with. So that cutaway process that you just saw in the video is now has a much more devastating effect, depriving the individual of the ability to experience reward satisfaction. And that's dopamine resistance. So originally, the A1 variant or allele was a survival advantage. But today, it's a survival disadvantage because of dopamine resistance. And dopamine resistance produces low dopamine function, which is characterized by a low number of dopamine receptors, reduced dopamine release, low dopamine responsiveness, impaired dopamine function, increase in the need for a dopamine fix, and an increase in excessive dopamine-stimulating thoughts and behaviors. So here is a table of various reward deficiency syndrome behaviors, which is a function of the reward genes. So we have everything from alcoholism, marijuana, cocaine, meth, heroin, sedatives, hypnotics, stimulants, smokeless and smoking tobacco, glucose or sugar and fat and food in general, thrill-seeking behaviors, sexual sadism, masochism, hypersexuality, gambling, internet gaming, ADD, ADHD, tics, Tourette syndrome, autism, stuttering, antisocial behavior, conduct disorder, intermittent explosive disorder, oppositional defiant, exhibitionism, kleptomania, pyromania, that's stealing things and burning things, anorexia, bulimia, bodybuilding, or otherwise known as body dysmorphic, hoarding, hair pulling, skin picking, non-suicidal self-injury like self-mutilation, pathological gambling, paranoid, schizoid, borderline, bipolar and depression, anger and pathological violence, narcissism, avoidance, dependence, shopaholism, workaholism, elite athleticism, anything that people do to excess just to achieve satisfaction and success is characterized or is qualified under the rubric of reward deficiency syndrome. One-third of the total U.S. population carries this A1 gene variant. Remember, it was a survival gene. That's over 100 million people. However, 50% of African Americans carry this gene, 58% of Hispanics carry it, 72% of Asians, and 85% of Native Americans. And you can see that this what once was a survival gene has now turned into a disadvantage, and you can, if you look at health statistics and addictions and things like that, you can see the progressive increase in some of these problems among these ethnic groups as a result. So as the head goes, so goes the body. Keep in mind, these people with reward deficiencies have difficulty experiencing the satisfying reward that others get from normally pleasurable and rewarding experiences, and turning off the intense desire and craving for pleasure-seeking thoughts and behaviors. So as I said earlier, this is reward deficiency syndrome, and we can't change our genes, but we can change gene expression. The brain reward is a KB220Z, nutrigenomic natural dopamine agonist, that means something that promotes dopamine function, that has been shown now in 30 studies to optimize gene expression, activate the dopaminergic reward pathway in the brain, and normalize dopamine function, even in people with these gene predispositions that have already been experiencing aberrant, pathological behavior. So, for example, there was a study done back in the 90s that showed, and this was the original formula of the brain reward without the Xentos ingredient, The formula significantly reduced relapse rates and enhanced recovery in DUI outpatient offenders over a 10-week period. Well, that's wonderful that it happens during this 10-week period, but what we really want to know is how long were they able to stay abstinent? Follow-up after 10 months revealed an average 83% continued overall recovery rate. Again, that was published in Psychoactive Drugs in 1990. So the other thing about that study was that, as you can see, there were dramatic reductions in stress, depression, anger, anxiety, drug craving, and build up to relapse score. A dramatic improvement in a reduction in these unhealthy behaviors. Conversely, there was a significant improvement in healthy behaviors, in self-confidence, in energy level, in restraint, well-being, and recovery. But I'm blown away by the fact that the energy was the most significant improvement of all, and that's because this is a survival gene. So it's turning back on, survival security, feeling good about yourself, and energy is being dramatically increased. You're turning back on the ability to make energy, manage energy, and remove waste. You're getting out of survival panic. So a separate study was done in 2007. Remember, that was done in 1990. Well, 17 years later, the study was pretty much duplicated, and you can see dramatic reductions in craving, in depression, and improvements in fatigue. It was remarkable. So average relapse rates of alcoholics is about 90% in 1 year. We went to the Las Vegas court system, and in a one-year outpatient recovery program for both federal and municipal court systems in the BioClarity Rehab Clinic in Vegas, the effects of the brain reward were evaluated. Now, we didn't have a commercial product back then, so the product had to be manufactured for this study. It was $300 a month. So the judges gave the individuals that, and we basically said to the judges, we want your worst relapse offenders, people that no matter what they've tried, they cannot stay sober. So this is a revolving door for the court. So they've seen these people numerous times. The court gave these people an option. You can either go to jail or get involved in the study, and if you get in the study, the court will pay the $300 a month for the first 6 months if you pay the $300 a month for the second 6 months, this month 7 through 12. Keep in mind, this is still a whole lot cheaper than incarceration. We got 57 individuals participating in this study. You would think that a significant relapse rate might be expected after month 7 on par with average relapse rates. Now, the relapse rate in this group was 93%, by the way. At 1 year, the alcoholism relapse rate was only 7%. There's no treatment center I'm aware of that has that kind of success rate. This is published in Advances in Therapy in 2007. This is actually, I think, my first study that I collaborated with Dr. Blum on. So taking the patented formula in the brain reward, greater than 80% of recovering alcoholics were able to abstain from taking a drink for an average of 11 months, which was the duration of the study period, also reducing white-knuckle sobriety and promoting a greater sense of happiness. Nutritionally supports over an 80% recovery rate and greater happiness. And by the way, improved recovery is one of the claims on the bottle. The patented formula in brain reward in this study, it was called Sin-10, was given to methadone addicts in conjunction with receiving Trexane to block opiate euphoria as a method of rapid detox. Compliance on Trexane alone was an average of 37 days. Trexane plus the brain reward formula increased compliance to 262 days, 7 times greater. The brain reward promotes dopamine sensitivity, compliance, and increased continuity. And it was published in 2004. So the patented formula in brain reward corrected food cravings. A preliminary study of 106 eating disordered females, anorexic and bulimics, was conducted at a medically supervised outpatient addiction treatment program called Recovery Systems, utilizing the patented brain reward formula for this application. In follow-up interviews, 6 randomly selected former eating disordered female clients, 3 of which were also chemically dependent, were contacted 9 months to 3 years post-treatment to evaluate the efficacy of the brain reward formula. Again, we're not looking at what happens right at treatment. We want to see how long they're able to stay abstinent and healthy. Follow-up confirmed significant initial benefits in elevated mood and freedom from compulsive eating behavior and even the ideation to to eat in 100% of the 6 subjects that were interviewed. In the other 100 patients, 98% experienced significant improvement in both mood and reduced sugar craving behavior. So this is one of my most favorite slides, by the way. The friendship and marriage, birds of a feather flock together. So I was sitting with Dr. Blum in his condo. It was 1 o'clock in the morning, which is about midday workday for him. And we were looking at some research from the University of California, San Diego, and that found that the A1 variant was common among friends up to 3 degrees of separation. So Dr. Blum looked up at me and he said, well, what's our next study going to be? And I said, well, who do you marry? And his eyes lit up. And we did a study, and we found that in a family with very serious reward deficiency syndrome behavior, the A1 allele was present in 100% of married males and females down 5 generations. And the only reason we stopped at 5 generations is that's all the people we could find alive. So don't look at your brother, sister, mother, father, uncle, cousin, and say they have a problem, because you carry the gene as well. It just manifests entirely different. Some of us might have some unhealthy behaviors. Others of us happen to be research scientists. So it manifests in a number of positive ways, but it makes us do everything to excess so that we can be successful and satisfied. So stress lowers brain endorphins. That was one of the steps in the brain reward cascade, and that increases craving behavior because endorphins are a rate-limiting factor for dopamine. In a triple-blind, placebo-controlled, quantitative electroencephalograph study, and you'll see the brain scan in a minute, the brain rewards significantly increased alpha with concomitant increases in low beta bands, that means increases at the same time, compared to placebo, resulting in normalization of brain function in protracted, abstinent, psychostimulant addicts. This was published in Postgraduate Medicine in 2010. We found that the brain reward actually caused almost a doubling of alpha waves and almost a tripling of low beta. That was phenomenal. The effects of the KB220Z, or the brain reward, on reward circuitry of 10 heroin addicts undergoing protracted abstinence, there was an average of 16.9 months that they were off heroin, was evaluated. The brain reward induced an increase in bold activation in the caudate accumbens dopaminergic pathways following 1 hour of acute administration. Furthermore, the brain reward also reduced resting state activity in the putamen of abstinent heroin addicts, and I'll explain these in a moment. In all 10 abstinent heroin-dependent subjects, 3 brain regions of interest were significantly activated from resting state by the brain reward compared to placebo. In fact, increased functional connectivity. We have reanimated the crosstalk between the different compartments of the brain called functional connectivity. It was observed in a putative network that included the dorsal anterior cingulate, medial frontal gyrus, nucleus accumbens, posterior cingulate, occipital cortical areas, and the cerebellum. We reanimated the interconnectivity crosstalk between the different compartments of the brain. We reestablished a complete circuit of thought. And that was pretty amazing. This was published in Postgraduate Medicine. So here's a picture. This is the site of the brain that makes dopamine. This is called the nucleus accumbens. And nobody's home. There's no activity there. And this is the area of the brain that lights up when the person is thinking about or engaging in relapse behavior. And 4th of July fireworks are going off here. These individuals are suffering what you heard is called white knuckle sobriety or white knuckle abstinence. 1 hour after one dose of the KB220Z or the brain reward, we've got some activity going on in the nucleus accumbens. This is why I call it the symphony of neurochemistry, because it takes about 2.5 weeks to start rebuilding new receptors. And this is happening in 1 hour. So they're there. So it's kind of like taking the cast off the arm and getting the ability to do a little bit of work with that arm. We're reactivating those tissues that have been atrophied and withered because of heroin addictions. You can see over here nothing was going on. They were, again, clinging to sobriety by a thread. And there's about a 60 to 70% reduction in craving behavior, according to what's lighting up here. So the brain reward ameliorates terrifying lucid nightmares in reward deficiency syndrome patients. The brain reward was associated with the elimination of unpleasant and or terrifying lucid dreams in 7 of 8 subjects. One very heavy cocaine abuser showed a minimal response. Quite frankly, a higher dose might have been needed. Each of the cases was diagnosed with a form of reward deficiency syndrome, including ADHD, ADD, and or Tourette's syndrome, and all of them suffered from some form of post-traumatic stress disorder and other psychiatric diagnoses as well. And then in another study, a 51-year-old obese woman diagnosed with post-traumatic stress disorder and depression had attempted suicide and experienced terrifying lucid nightmares linked to sexual and physical abuse from early childhood by family members, including her alcoholic father. Medical records reveal changes in the frequency, intensity, and nature of these dreams after the administration of the brain reward, the KB220Z. By the way, this KB220Z is on the bottle of the brain reward. The patient reported her first experience of an extended period of happy dreams. The second 39-year-old post-traumatic stress disorder woman patient also suffered from lucid nightmares. The second patient was administered the brain reward to also reduce methadone withdrawal symptoms and reported dreams full of happiness and laughter. What incredibly wonderful changes. This is Chrissy. Chrissy was a movie industry executive assistant, and she developed carpal tunnel syndrome, had surgery, and they put her on painkillers, Oxycontin actually, and she became addicted. And she was dealing with this for 5 years. She got hopelessly addicted to class 2 narcotics by the workers' comp pain management doc, and she developed a severe addiction ultimately to Suboxone. After about a half a dozen changes in meds, they put her on Suboxone. Her marriage was failing. Her young child was impacted. She had fibromyalgia. The workers' comp doctor even sought permission to implant a narcotics pump to keep her medicated. The AME ordered detox and treatment instead, and she was unemployable. She actually looks kind of like a crack addict there. So she was put on the dose recommended on the bottle of brain reward, which would equal 6 capsules a day. And in 5.5 months, after 2 years of being on Suboxone, in 5.5 months, she's off. She actually ended up doing a press conference on the steps of the Capitol building in Sacramento, California, the capital of California. And it you know, made television back then. But anyway, there's Chrissy now. She's drug-free, a functional wife, mother, and employee. She's a happy camper. So the brain reward affects cravings and body composition as well. Keep in mind, excess fat storage is an energy-conserving response to survival threats. Fat is survival insurance. So increased energy conservation promotes increased cravings and energy consumption. When your body's in a state of survival panic, it conserves energy. So increased energy deprivation or expenditure, if you go out and run a marathon, is going to promote energy savings, generally as fat. Excess fat retention is another epigenetic-induced reward deficiency syndrome condition that positively responds to nutritional support of the brain reward, which is a nutrigenomic, remember, nutrition affecting gene expression, neuroadaptogen complex. So a 2-year study was conducted to evaluate the efficacy of OptiFast, which is a meal replacement drink, kind of on the order of MetaFast. It was a fasting program. Following its termination, 247 of the subjects of that study who had difficulty attaining and or maintaining their desired weight made up the experimental group in a second 2-year study. 84.2% were female, and 73% of them were morbidly obese. The experimental group participated in a very low-calorie fasting program and was divided into 2 subgroups, one taking Centrum, and there were 117 in that group, and the other group expressing the highest complaint of difficulty in weight loss. We got the hardest cases in the 4-year study. Took the brain reward plus Centrum, and there were 130 in that group. Now, after the second 2-year term, compared to the Centrum control group, the Centrum and the brain reward, the patented formula, achieved the following comparative results: a 2-fold decrease in weight loss for both males and females, a 70% decrease in food craving for females, and a 63% decrease in males. Keep in mind, ladies, your XX chromosome, and guys, we are XY chromosome, and all of the immune system information is in the X chromosome. So, ladies, you have twice as much immune system protection as men. But when things go wrong, they go wrong 2 to 4 times as often, and are often 2 to 4 times as severe. But in this case, ladies, you got the best benefit. In fact, the women experienced a 60% decrease in binge eating compared to the men's 41% decrease in binge eating. Most importantly, similar to the first study, which actually I didn't show you in the essence of time, the KB220, the Brain Reward group, only gained back 14.7% of the weight lost during the fasting program. The Centrum Control group regained 41.7% of the weight lost. Now, keep in mind that 100% of weight loss programs fail 95% of the time in 2 to 5 years. And that deprivation, you know, fasting program actually causes accelerated weight regain, rebound weight gain, yo-yo dieting. The rapid weight loss programs have contributed more to the obesity epidemic than the poor diet did in the first place. So these are extraordinary results. Statistical analysis also revealed that morbid obesity and binge eating scores were significant predictors of just how beneficial the brain reward would be at preventing weight gain after 2 years. Translation, the more you need it, the better it works. So the brain reward works. And again, there's 30 clinical studies showing the brain reward positively influences gene expressions that drive the brain's control of every bodily function, especially in the dopamine receptor genes and its reaction to environmental lifestyle forces. Brain reward promotes reduced cravings and weight management, greater self-control, stress relief, reduced anxiety, supports easier detox. This is one of the claims on the bottle, and that's dose-dependent. Importantly, no more feelings of helplessness. And most importantly, no more need for a stigma. You're not broken. You're not worthless. Don't dump on yourself. You have an imbalance in the chemistry of the brain. It's a hardware problem, not a software problem. You can affect gene expression. People that have this gene have a Maserati brain, and they're feeding it Ford Fiesta fuel. So we have to up the quality of fuel. Brain reward increases that. And it helps to normalize gene expression, and it results in increased energy, vitality, and a sense of wellness, greater focus, concentration, and cognition or awareness, improved decision-making or executive function, elevated mood, and a greater sense of happiness. And it's not a drug. Now, there are a number of companies out there, as I said in the beginning, that make some of these claims. But this is profound scientific validation. There's 12 references on this page. There's another 12 references on this page. That's 24 of the 30. This is a tremendous substantiation. So we have scientific validation, but that's not enough. I took at the time when we had 18 clinical studies, I took them to our attorneys that specialize in nutrition regulatory law and asked them to review the science that I gave them, the 18 studies, plus over 180 other studies validating the dopaminergic premise. And they gave me an 18-page letter. And this is the conclusion. After a comprehensive review of 200-plus clinical and literature studies over a six-month period, it is our opinion that the claims outlined in this letter are adequately substantiated. Specifically, the claims meet the FTC and FDA standards of competent and reliable scientific evidence when used in the amounts and promoted to the target population studied. All the claims are reviewed and qualified while keeping in mind the totality of scientific evidence available. So not only do we have scientific validation, we have legal validation. This firm has been involved in over 2,000 cases. They've litigated over 450 cases. They have never lost a case, and they are telling us that our claims, which there were 33 claims, are all valid based on the science. V&I absolutely, categorically provides unsurpassed quality and credibility that you can believe in and rely on. We will not sacrifice your or risk your most treasured assets of time. You can never get that back. Of your credibility, of the relationships that result from that credibility or are lost by a lack of it, and of your finances, of your health. We won't risk any of those treasured assets. And believe me, no other company has all of this. V&I stands alone, so far above everybody else, protecting you and your ability to be a beacon of light in health, hope, and abundance. Thank you very much.